So today we're going to look at the prose lesson, A Wrong Man in Worker's Paradise. And we will see how the writer, Rabindranath Tagore, brings to the fore the importance of art. Now, today's lesson will be basically on trying to look at the pre-reading questions. We're going to look at the glossary and a few other things which will help us to sort of prepare ourselves for the prose lesson itself. So let's take it from here. I expect all of you to have your books with you and focus on the pre-reading questions, write down those inputs, and when we get back to the lesson and when we get back and we do the class, at that point of time maybe, you know, we can ponder on those questions which on which you had prepared your notes. So let's begin without wasting further time. Let's go to the prose lesson written by Rabindranath Tagore, A Wrong Man in Worker's Paradise. So as a part of the unit 1, we have the prose lesson. It's titled as A Wrong Man in Worker's Paradise, and it's written by Rabindranath Tagore. It's a beautiful story. So before we get into the story, as I always do, we will be looking at the pre-reading activity. Now, the pre-reading activity becomes very, very important because it forms the basis for what we do when we get into the prose lesson, right? So, the first question under pre-reading, it's found in your textbook. Let me just tell you the page number 7. So, on page number 7, you have the pre-reading questions. You can turn to them. The first question is very simple one. It's, what are your hobbies? So basically, you, many times when we do the pre-reading activity, you can sort of guess what the story is going to be about. So it could be about hobbies. So hobbies, this is the first question that teachers ask you when you have your introductory class, and you have all sorts of answers for that. So that's one thing that it's just trying to, we are just trying to open up your mind and make you think about your hobbies. So I'll move ahead. Just jot down, you know, in a piece of paper, you can jot down these things, because, you know, when we get to the prose, we will discuss all these things. The second question is, do you like any fine art? So when we say fine arts, we are looking at painting, music, dance, or sculpture. Not all of us are made for these. Some of us have been blessed with, you know, the special skill of being able to paint, music, dance, sculpt, or even, you know, there's something called as doodling, and there are some students who are pretty good at doodling. I knew of a student who was extremely good with it. I think she's making a career out of it, as far as I know. I know of at least two or three students of mine, your seniors, who basically have turned their hobby into their career. Right. The third question is, did you learn any art form when you were in school? Now, one thing is being blessed with a special talent, maybe you're born with that talent to sculpt or paint, but some of us have learned it at school. No, you're not extremely good initially, but as time passed by, as you spent more and more time, you became good at it. So did you learn any art form when you were in school? Just think about your, go back, a flashback to your school days, and just jot down those points. And if yes, how good were you at it? Now, this is a question we are trying to probe you into thinking about, how good were you at it? Now, many times now, nobody would have asked you this question about how good were you at painting or music, but maybe this is after a very long time someone is asking you, and your teacher is asking you today, how good were you at it? Rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10. If I were to ask you, please do it for me. So write down the art form which you are very good at, and then you can jot down, give a point on a 10-point scale, give a score for yourself. That's going to be very important for you even as we go ahead and do the other questions and the prose lesson itself. Right. The next question is, did you take art seriously or did you look at it only as a hobby? A little while ago, I told you about how some students have taken it up as a career. But all of us don't do that. You know, I know of many cricketers who just play because they love to play the game. They know that they are not the Virat Kohli types. They are pretty good, but they know, they think that they are never going to make it to the state team or the Indian team. So they do it more as a hobby. So did you take art seriously? If you painted, if you're good at painting or sculpting or whatever, music, dance, we missed that out. So how did you take it seriously? That's the question. Did you enjoy learning it? You know, how was the, you know, that particular R when you were taken to, you know, the room where you did your painting or the hall where you all danced at school? Did you enjoy it? You know, one thing is you're supposed to do it because it's one of the things on which you are graded, subjects in which you are graded. The other thing is whether you really took it seriously. Did you enjoy learning it? If yes, did you ever consider pursuing art as a career? If no, why not? Now that's going to be a very, very important question. If no, why not? Why did you not think about it as a career option? Many times, a lot of things that you do, I'm sure you agree with me, a lot of things that you do at home, you know, some of those decisions that you take are taken because your parents wanted you to become an engineer, they wanted you to take up business or science. But if you were good at painting, why didn't you think of it as a career? There are enough icons in the field of art and science. And, but why did you not think of pursuing it as a career is the next question that I am posing for you guys. So keep thinking about it. The question is, why have you not thought of pursuing it as a career? As I told you earlier, some of them feel that they're not extremely good at it, but then it's very important for you to identify that there are others who should be able to tell you how good you are. So that's the first, that's the question that you need to ask yourself, and then maybe you can take a call on it. So the next question is, can our hobby become our career? If no, what compels us to keep our hobbies separate from our career? I think the key word there is compel. Is there something which is compelling you from keeping your hobby separate from your career? Why can't you convert your hobby into your career is something that I think all of you need to think about. So it's very, very important for you to think on those lines. So keep looking at those options or rather the reasons which have compelled you to keep your hobby separate from your career. That could be a very, very important question even as you're going to take some very, very important decisions about your career in a year or two. Even as we've seen during the COVID time, because of COVID-19, a lot of new careers have emerged. There are a lot of old careers which have sort of became, you know, they became obsolete and they no longer have value. There are people who lost their jobs because they were not indispensable. They could be easily replaced. So these are things that, you know, it's good that we think about some of these things. So what compels us to keep a hobby separate from your career is a very, very important question. I want you to ponder on this question and jot down a few points. I tell you that it's going to become a very, very, it's going to help you in a big way when we go and do the lesson. But more importantly, this is a very, very important question for life. And all the time, whenever I do this lesson, I always remind students of the beautiful movie Three Idiots, and I remind them about the role. I think it's Farhan. Farhan has got a good role in that movie, where basically he goes on to pursue his hobby as a career and become successful at it. But before that happens, he has to take a big journey through this engineering college, and where he's not especially successful. So I would want you to think about that incident when you sort of write these reasons. The next question that I'm going to ask you from the pre-reading is, what value do you think art or artists have in our society? That's a very, very important question in India, because I know that there are certain countries in the world, for example, Paris is called as a cultural capital of the world, right? In terms of culture, there are places like London, Paris, certain places in the United States and other countries in the world where artists are very, very important people. Now, does that happen in our society, in India, in this part of the world, in the subcontinent, is something that you need to think about. What is the value that art or artists get in our society? Are they people who really get the recognition that they receive, that they are supposed to receive, or they are largely ignored? At this point of time, you could also think about those. I'm not talking about people who made it big in the field of art, who are well educated. They could be people at the grassroots. They could be people in villages who are artists who got a special skill, but then nobody cares for what they do, or the artifacts that they prepare are of not much value in the society that we live in. So this is a very important question that you need to think about. How do we understand value? How do we estimate the value of anything, right? That's a question. You know, maybe some of the things that are very valuable, think of gold and diamonds. You don't think much about the coal, which you know, in the coal mines, which is responsible for a certain percentage of electricity in our state. So how do we understand value? Is it on the basis of the availability? It's on the basis of someone telling you it's valuable? Is it on the basis of its looks? So that's as far as the you know, minerals are concerned. But when it comes to people, you know, for example, during the COVID-19 time, who are those people whom we value the most? They are people who are there in the front line, right? When we say frontline, we are talking about medical doctors, we are talking about the policemen, we are talking about all those people who made a huge impact in our day-to-day life during COVID times. Right, the next question in the pre-reading says, how do we understand value? How do we estimate the value of anything, right? So I think that's already done. Is usefulness the only criteria to judge value? Do all things that are useful give us happiness? And is everything that gives us happiness also useful? Now that's a pretty thought-provoking question, because it says, is usefulness the only criteria to judge value? Are we going to... Now it's a very typical mentality that we have down here in our country. We always think that people who do engineering or medicine are of a certain value, and people who are into clerical jobs, you know, who are, for example, who are working for the call center, are maybe not that useful. Now this is a question that I want to put to you, something which thoughts which existed certainly 5-10 years ago. Today, if you look at a particular stream, for example, if you're talking about a branch of study like a Bachelor in Arts, is of great value as of today. But it almost didn't count a few years ago. If you were a BA in let's say English, or BA in mass communication, or political science, or history, you were sort of heading towards writing maybe some competitive exam and getting into a government job, or you were doing it only because you think that you want to take history as a paper for your civil services. I'm just giving you a few examples for you to understand the local context. For a very long time in India, engineering and medicine was considered the most valuable. They were considered the most valuable professions in India. So just to help you to understand, although the story doesn't talk about this, but for you to understand this concept of usefulness, I am giving you these examples. And the question goes on, it says, do all things that are useful give us happiness? Now, the word used here is happiness. Now, how do you define happiness? There are different people who define happiness in different ways. There are a lot of people who have the most amount of money in the world, but they're not happy. Okay? There are people who just make the least, or they make just about enough money to have a square meal, who are happy and content. And then, you know, you have a word called as contentment. So we're not getting into terminology, but a very simple question: do all things that are useful give us happiness? Now, you have a printer, for example, print, scan, copier. It'll do your job, but does it give you happiness? Right? There are people who enjoy music, right? They listen to a lot of music. For them, music gives happiness. But then music as a profession is only for those who are experts at it. So I'm just posing a lot of questions here just to help you to understand, because this I think is by far one of the most important questions that we're doing today, right? And is everything that gives us happiness also useful? Now, for example, someone who is on drugs, let's say, for him it gives him or her it gives that person a high for a certain period of time, and he considers it as happiness. But you know, it's doing a lot of damage for him. You know, alcoholism is another. We knew what happened when the markets opened after lockdown in all our cities in India. The liquor shops just sold everything that they had in a few hours. So, I mean, alcoholism is real. For some people, it could give some form of happiness. But then in the long run, if you become an alcoholic, it's actually very harmful for your body. Now, I'm not saying this is right, that's wrong. I'm just trying to help you to understand this concept of usefulness, happiness, and this whole idea of whether everything that gives us happiness is also useful, because that forms the crux of what we are trying to understand through this prose lesson. So just if you've understood these two questions, I think we are getting close to what we need to have clarity on when we move ahead and do the prose lesson. Right. What purpose do the arts serve? Why do artists pursue art? What is the purpose of arts? Some people may say it's just a way of passing your time. You know, is it fetching? Is it a career option for you? There's a beautiful place called as Lamakan, very close to our college, and you know, a lot of people join there, like-minded people. There's poetry reading happening, people read, there's a book reading session, a few artists come there and they display their pieces of art. Now, the question that the author is asking us is, what purpose do the arts serve? You know, and that's a very, very important question, I believe. So what purpose do the arts serve? Is it just for, calming you down, or it's just a way of passing time, or is it something that you do in your free time, or is it only for those people who are or is it only for the aficionados of art, you know, people who are knowledgeable, enthusiastic about some form of art or the other? So this particular question, I think this, you need to understand the context here, and if you're not understanding the context, you know, you may not enjoy the lesson there. So what purpose do the arts serve? Why do artists pursue art? What is their value? Why do they pursue it. They pursue it because it brings them fame in certain cases. We had a very famous artist by name M.F. Hussain, right? There are a lot of Telangana artists who have become popular after the formation of the state. Some of them are doing it for fame. But what about those artists? You know, a little while ago, I just showed you a picture of the Nirmal toys. You know, there are people who in this particular part of Adilabad, where, you know, they make toys, and it's a very traditional way of making those toys, right? Some of them may be pursuing art because that's what they feel they are made for. You know, it gives them joy, it gives them something called as job satisfaction. You know, we talk about companies, the happiest place to work with, there are too many of them. So people would say, you know, why do I work somewhere? This is what I'm good at. I do this. I don't work for anybody. I mean, I don't work under anybody. This is my own business. This is what I'm good at. So I'll go ahead and do it. You know, and when I'm talking about artists, I'm also talking about, you know, this particular place in Telangana. We're talking about this particular textile park. We started in a place called Sirsilla in Telangana, where you know, the government is doing all that can to sort of sustain this wonderful profession of weaving, right? So we are talking about all these professions. We are talking about the value which you know, art should have. So when we say what purpose do these arts serve, they serve a lot of purpose. You know, just like you have a doctor or an engineer or a person working for the army, you also have these artists who are blessed with a certain skill, and they need to be encouraged, right? So the last question, it goes like this: the history of art is as old as human history. Why do you think even the people who lived in caves painted on cave walls? So that is one particular question that I would want to pose for you students. So you just I want a response from you guys. So that, you know, jot down a few points. Why do you think even the people who lived in caves painted on the cave walls? What was the purpose? You know, they had other things to do as well. They needed to gather their hunt in order to survive. They needed to maybe raise crops. But then apart from that, they also painted on the cave wall. So these are a few thoughts, so which I want you to have with you before we go ahead and do this particular story by Rabindranath Tagore. It's a beautiful story, but before we go ahead and do it, I want all of you to ponder on these questions, and that would sort of prepare the ground for us to go ahead and do the prose lesson.
Well, I hope it was a useful session, because we didn't directly go into the lesson. We sort of looked at the pre-reading questions. We tried to understand whether they make sense today. The lesson itself, the story itself, does it make sense today? We looked at various forms of art, which, you know, very often are ignored, but still could be the source of somebody's sustenance, may be the reason for somebody being successful in life, may be the reason for somebody achieving whatever he or she has achieved. So that's basically what we did today. Hopefully, you know, it was a useful session for you. I would want you to go back to those few questions on which we spent about 30 to 40 minutes, and I want you to sort of read, reread, make notes, I would be happy if you can read the story itself, because, you know, you'll be coming better prepared, because I don't believe in reading the story and trying to make you understand. Those are things that we normally do at school. But what we do is we read to comprehend, we read between the lines, we do all this so that, you know, we get the best out of the story. So even before we go and do the prose lesson, that's the next thing on the agenda. I would want you to prepare yourselves to do the prose lesson in an effective manner. Thank you so much. Have a great day.